Earth is a blue planet engulfed by water. But in this desolate chunk of northern Chile, you won't find a single drop. Wedged between the Pacific Ocean and coastal volcanoes to the west, and the Andes to the east, is Atacama, the driest desert in the world. ...600 miles long and narrow, on average just 100 miles wide, it's the same size as Iowa. Now, scientists are on a mission to find out how it was made. The investigation begins in the sleepy town of Quiagua. A rare green oasis. Its only lifeline is a stream. Trickling 300 miles from the Andes to the Pacific. It is home to the official government rain gauge, so geologist John Houston has come here to find out how dry the driest place on Earth really is.
This is a pluviometer. It measures the rainfall every day.
Ah, okay.
For Marissa Vera, a government scientist, it's a job with few surprises.
How much rainfall has this instrument recorded?
In the last 15 years, less than 1 millimeter per year.
Less than 1 millimeter a year?
Yes.
Or was it every year?
It rains only 3 years.
That's incredible.
Exactly.
So less than 1 millimeter a year.
On average, it rains 3/100ths of an inch a year. It would take a century for Atacama's rainfall to fill a coffee cup. How does this compare with other deserts?
Here we have a cylinder, and I'm going to show you the difference between the amount of rainfall per annum here and the amount of rainfall in other deserts. So if I fill this jar up, right up to about there, that is roughly the rainfall that you get in the Sahara. Now, if I pour most of that away, we get to that level. That represents what we have in the Mojave Desert, 5 inches per annum. If I pour all that away, except for that little drop in the bottom there, and that's the equivalent of what we have here in the heart of the Atacama Desert. That is such a small amount of rainfall that it means it's the driest place on Earth.
At the equator, moisture-rich air gets heated by the sun and rises. As this hot, wet air flows away from the equator, it quickly sheds its water as rain. By the time it reaches the two tropic latitudes, the air has lost nearly all of its moisture, resulting in no rain on the land below. The mystery, though, is why Atacama gets so much less rain than any place else. Scientists hope to crack the case by figuring out how Atacama first formed. On the hunt for clues, Houston travels deep into the true desert. This closely guarded location was discovered during routine mapping by geologists back in the 70s. But the huge significance of their find wasn't realized until 1998. This band of boulders is the single most important clue to Atacama's beginnings. It's a delicate rock called gypsum. A simple test shows how fragile it is.
If I pour a little bit of water on top of that, you will see that it very rapidly falls apart. What's happening here, of course, is that when I'm putting water on this, you see it dissolve. I mean, it's just going to fall apart.
The survival of gypsum as a solid rock tells scientists there hasn't been any heavy rain since the rock formed. So the next step was to date it and figure out when this place became dry. Gypsum can't be directly dated, but by analyzing fossils in the surrounding rocks, the awesome age of the desert was revealed. Atacama is a staggering 150 million years old. 150 million years ago, the Atacama Desert was a seabed covered by ocean waters. But today, some areas in the desert are 2 miles above sea level. In the journey to find out how this happened, scientists take the investigation to the eastern edge of the desert. This strange landscape is the largest geyser field in the southern hemisphere.
We're up at the El Tatio geyser field. You can see around us that there's plenty of hot springs and geysers. There's plenty of steam around, and this is because the air is cool and the water is hot, and so you have a lot of steam and bubbling springs.
The boiling water is being heated deep underground.
The geysers and the hot water that you find up at El Tatio are indications that you have a body of hot rock underneath us. And another indication is you have a bunch of volcanoes surrounding this basin.
The earth here is violently alive. Molten rock erupts onto the surface, forming volcanoes. The fiery volcanoes and the boiling geysers are evidence of a turbulent process happening deep beneath the desert. Here, the Pacific Ocean crust is being forced underneath South America, much like a spatula going underneath a pizza. This geological process is called subduction.
You have the Pacific plate colliding with the continental crust, and the Pacific plate is actually heavier and it slides underneath the continental crust. And as it does so, it heats because it gets to a depth of about 60 miles and it becomes molten.
This crucial depth is called a melting zone. Hot molten rock then thrusts upward to form the active volcanoes that ring the El Tatio geyser field. This process gives scientists a hint to what lifted the desert out of the ocean. More clues are found on the opposite side of the desert. Geologists know that these coastal hills were also once volcanoes. Today, they're completely dead, but modern dating techniques show that they first erupted over 195 million years ago. It's a crucial piece of evidence which reveals when the Pacific plate first began to force its way beneath South America. At that time, the desert, indeed all of Chile, was underwater. Over time, the melting zone was pushed further and further inland, first igniting the coastal volcanoes. As the melting zone passed beneath the desert, it formed new crust, thickening and raising the land. The Atacama Desert slowly emerged. Fifty million years ago, this same process began to raise the Andes. Today, the melting zone is 140 miles inland, and the molten rock it produces ignites volcanoes. and fuels El Tatio's geysers. But as it passed under the Atacama Desert, it also left behind this. Chuquicamata, the largest open-pit copper mine in the world. Volcanic processes concentrated the copper ore here, but it was the desert's unique climate that locked it in place.
This area of northern Chile produces some of the largest and most important copper deposits in the world, and this is largely due to the very dry climate. Most of the erosion on the Earth's surface is caused by water. So here, where there's so little rainfall and there's very little surface water, there's not very much erosion, and so the copper deposit has actually remained intact.
As a result, this barren wilderness is one of the most valuable pieces of land on the planet.